Welcome everybody to this demonstration of SmartExporter for SAP. It's going to be a high-level overview of SmartExporter, more from the point of view of an end user, not technical. We'll leave that for a later date. We can provide documentation as well as the SAP certification that was achieved by Audit for this application. We can send that upon request. SmartExporter for SAP is a very simple user interface. The whole concept behind it is allow you to take some of the load off of the IT shop and be able to do extractions of data directly from your SAP data sources to your IDEA project. And this is the 5,000 foot overview of how you would actually go about doing that. The first thing that we're going to need to do is establish a connection. And the connection is going to be using the credentials that are your SAP username and password. Your SAP basis and administrator will help you set this connection up. So first of all, choose the connection link. Each instance of SmartExporter can contain up to 10 connection strings, 10 different instances. So if your company has a dev environment, a QA environment, and then a production environment, you can have individual connection strings to each one of those environments. The way that you do that is to create a connection string. I have one created already, and I'm going to choose to edit that string to show you how that is done. Your first step is to name the connection. This needs to be descriptive. This connection going to the dev box, QA box, production box. Name it something that would be meaningful to you when you're looking in that list. We're going to see scattered throughout the application some connection types and more advanced type features. I'm not going to cover those in this presentation. Again, that's going to be more in the line of what your network administrator, your SAP basis administrator would handle, rather than the end user. Now, to establish this connection, you're going to need to know the IP address of the SAP server, a system number if your company uses one, as well as the SAP router string if it's used. Then you'll enter the client that you're looking to extract data from and your SAP username and password. This is the same username and password that you would use to access a transaction code such as SE16 to be able to pull data one table at a time. The advanced features down below, again, we'll leave those for your basis administrator and security administrator to configure. The next step is to test the connection. Go ahead and click Test Connection. And you can see a green check mark indicates that your credentials were accepted and you have access to the SAP data dictionary. The next step that we're going to do is go to the Home tab again. And on the Home tab, we're going to establish global options. Click the link and follow the links that are listed on the left-hand side of the screen. General options include whether you're creating a data request online or offline. SmartExporter contains a snapshot of the tables and the columns within those tables for your particular dictionary, and you can work offline. The next thing is tracing. Tracing is if there happens to be an issue or a challenge, help desk will have you turn that on and it'll create a text file with everything that's talked about between SmartExporter and your SAP system as it's going across the network. The next option, data request. A data request is a query. It's a saved view of the data that you're going to extract data with. And by saving a data request in a global format, you can modify individual data requests to match the needs as required. We like this application because it creates native IDEA files, .imd files. But you can extract data to CSV, text, access, and some German tax format as needed. Desktop and server. The desktop and server applications work exactly the same. Functionally, they're the same. It has to do with environment and also the application that you purchased, a little bit more advanced for what we need to talk about today. Where do you want the data to be extracted to? You can have this go to the Q drive or the Z drive. A lot of my internal audit shops will have extraction go directly to a drive that only the internal audit credentials allow access to. I have it set to the number one demo on my C drive. If you look down here in the lower left-hand corner, that's where my IDEA project is pointed also. So when I run this data extraction, the actual data files will show up in my project automatically. All right, again, some more advanced capabilities. How big of a packet? How much data do you want to come across the line in one chunk? Your administrator and your network people are going to be the best resource for this. And they're going to want some input into it because it does have an impact on resources on the SAP server. Regional, SmartExporter was developed by Audicon. They are the German distributor of IDEA, the equivalent to automation services in Germany. So you get two flavors, English and German. The data dictionary is the list of tables and the columns in those tables inside of your SAP instance. There's a bunch of different versions that are supported. Choose the version that you have, make it your default dictionary, and then anytime you create a favorite or a query, you're using a real-time view of the tables and the columns that's contained in your data dictionary. If the SAP administrator has modified that dictionary, you can download a copy of it and then make it your standard and do all of your queries based on your specific dictionary. The News tab, it actually turns on a little scrolling information if you want to. I typically have it turned off. About SmartExporter, if there's an issue, the help desk is going to want to know what version and some other information about the copy that you have. All right, let's go back to the Home tab. Now that we've established a connection and set some global options, we're going to create a data request. That's where the data is downloaded from the data dictionary on your SAP system and made usable. The ultimate goal of that is a favorite or a saved query. I'm going to click the favorites and show you the list of favorites that I've already created. And then when I double click one of these, I'll do this simple join example. It takes me to the screen that I would see if I had clicked the Create Data Request button. Name the data request. Give it something that's useful, something descriptive. Add it to the favorites on the first try because then it becomes part of your list. You can use it time and time again. And then put some notes about it so one of your colleagues, when they try to use this data request, they'll be able to read. What does this thing do? Next thing, choose the connection that you want. Dev, QA, production, what have you. Highlight it, it becomes part of your query. And lastly, select the tables. The search feature inside of this particular option allows you to search the name of the column and the description of the column. So if you know you want the BSEG table, put your mouse in the search, start typing BSEG. The options are narrowed down to anything that contains that sequence of characters, by name or by description. When you're happy with it, click it. It becomes part of your data extraction. Clear the box, type a new name, add another table, and then continue on until you've added all of the tables that you need to download for that particular extraction. The next step is to look at filters. These are global filters. If the table you chose contains the filter that you apply, it will be applied to that table. If the column is not present, simply doesn't get included. Fields and filters are table specific. So now that I have selected a few tables, individually I can choose the columns within those tables. Same filtering mechanism works. Choose a table, put your mouse in the search box, start typing the name of a column or a description of a column, and the list will be narrowed down, and then you simply just choose all of the columns that you're interested in downloading at one time. Choose the next table and do the same thing. Now, if you need to further filter the data, we put some global filters in there, but if I want to put specific filters, choose a table, choose the Filters tab, and you can see the BUKRS column equal to 1000 is a specific filter that I added just for this table. All you do is click the button and choose any column in the table, choose an operator, and then give it a value, and it becomes specific to this table. All right, these three buttons up here. Once you've established your tables and your columns and any filters, you can click the button to verify access to the tables. Let's go back and look at the fields and choose to verify access. What's going to happen now is I get a green check mark if my username and password allows me to see those tables and the columns. If I get a red X, I don't have access. You notice if I put my mouse over the top of one of the columns, it'll tell me if that is a key value or if it's not. The next thing I can do is check the size of the download. Clicking this button right here will actually have SmartExporter assemble what's called a query plan, do a quick check of how many rows and how big the data will be downloaded across the web when you push the button. It's good to know. If you don't put the proper filters on and you accidentally tell the system to download you 400 million rows, you could be there a while. You might want to put some filtering on it and skinny that record set down, get specific data that's very relevant and valid for the analysis that you're currently doing. You can also do a quick preview of the data table by table. It'll show you what the first 100 records look like for any specific table. All right, next we're going to go to the joins category. SmartExporter was created to allow you to not only download table by table by table, but to create joins between tables to make the record set that comes across the network much smaller. As an example, the BSEG table, there's no facility inside of SAP to filter that for 1/4 worth of data. In SmartExporter, I can join that BSEG table to the appropriate table and filter it to 1/4 worth of data, greatly reducing the size and the volume of data that comes across the network. It's a little bit more of a technical subject than we probably need to get into right now, how to configure joins, what the different types of joins are. But what I'll tell you is that it's very well documented, and you're going to have to do a little bit of studying to make sure that you can properly configure a join in order to get it to be efficient for you. All right, next step is options. Remember those global options that we put in up in the first part of this presentation. Those were inherited by this particular data request, and then you can go in and modify each individual item on an item-by-item basis. If I wanted this particular request to do a CSV, I could change it for this request only. If I wanted it to go to a different location, I could change that. If I wanted to change the priority, I could change that and change the packet size also. All right. Last step, hit finish. I like to immediately look at the data request summary. What that does is it shows me what I'm going to do. I'm going to join this table to this table on that column. These are the output columns that I want from the first table. These are the output columns I want from the second table. Everything about the join, everything about the data request is documented in this small summary. I can place this request in a queue and schedule it for some time in the future. Might make sense to put it at 4 in the morning on Thursday because I know that's a significantly less busy time for my SAP system. I can make it an offline data request. If I've got colleagues that are using SmartExporter in another location, this will export the request to an XML file that I can email to them. They can import it and run it on their side. Maybe double check me. Save it and exit. That'll save it, put you back to the home screen, and you can go on to the next data request creation routine. And lastly, let's go ahead and do data request now. Data request now opens up a small dialog box that says table LFA1 is part of a join but was not selected to be downloaded. What that's telling me is SmartExporter allows you to download the source tables as well as the joined table. I've chosen to only download the joined result. That's going to greatly minimize the amount of data that's getting pushed across the line. When the data request finishes, hit close. And let's minimize SmartExporter. Go over to IDEA. There's the joined table and the data. So what I've been able to see is SmartExporter will allow me to create a request to take data directly out of my SAP system into my IDEA project as a .imd or an IDEA database.